Welcome to Empowered Living. I'm your host, Kenny Collier. I want to thank you for joining me on this week's edition. For the last few weeks, we've been looking at how science confirms the Bible, how they're not in contradiction ever. And if they are, we believe in God's word and wait for science to just catch up and prove his word to be true. Wherever the Bible speaks of things of a scientific nature, it has never been, nor will it ever be wrong. So last week, we started looking in this area about Noah's Ark and the global flood. We looked at how the ark was more than big enough and built well enough to not only survive the flood, but also to carry the animals and Noah's family to safety. We also looked at how many animals were necessary of each kind to be on the ark and how there was plenty of room for all of them to fit. This week, I want to take a look at how the flood was a global flood. Now, some would say that it was a local flood. But we should expect that if water covered the entire world, at some point, we should be able to see evidence of it. Many Christians are trying to marry the idea of millions of years with the Bible and that the flood wasn't a global but a local event. Many Bible study notes push this idea into the text. So let's take a look at this. Let's just start logically. Number one, ask this question. If it was a local flood, why did Noah have to build an ark? Could he not have just moved somewhere else where the flood was not going to happen? We do that all the time when we know high waters are coming. We just escape that area. Number two, why did God send animals and birds to the ark? Could not he have just sent them away from the flood waters, somewhere else upon the earth where the flood waters weren't going to reach? And then number three, after the flood, God put a rainbow in the sky saying he would never do this again. It was a sign of the covenant he made with man at that point. We have had lots of local floods since the time of Noah. So if local flood is what happened, then God would have broken his promise many times over since the days of Noah. And we know God doesn't lie or break his promises. What does the Bible say in this area? In Genesis chapter 6 and verse 17, it says, "And behold, I myself am bringing floodwaters on the earth to destroy from under heaven all flesh, save Noah and his family, in which is the breath of life, everything that is on the earth shall die." It doesn't say everything in a certain region shall die. And then Genesis chapter 7 and verse 19 says this, "The waters prevailed exceedingly on the earth, and all the high hills under the whole heaven were covered. The waters prevailed 15 cubits, that's 20 to 25 feet above every mountain. All flesh died that moved on the earth, birds, cattle, beasts, every creeping thing that creeps on the earth, and every man, all in whose nostrils was the breath of the spirit of life, and all that was on dry land died. So he destroyed all living things which were on the face of the ground, both man, cattle, creeping thing, and bird of the air. They were destroyed from the earth. Only Noah and those who were with him on the ark remained alive, and the waters prevailed on the earth for 150 days. Scripture is very clear. These verses aren't hard to interpret. So, what are the flood evidences that we expect to see on the earth? We expect to see millions of dead things buried in rock layers, laid down by water, all over the earth. And that's what we find. One of the evidences we find is the example of marine fossils high above sea level. Now, this is from a book by Andrew Snelling. He's a doctor, a geologist, and it says this. "It is beyond dispute among geologists that on every continent we find fossils of sea creatures in rock layers which today are high above sea level. For example, we find marine fossils in most of the rock layers of the Grand Canyon. This includes the topmost layer in the sequence called the Kaibab limestone exposed at the rim of the canyon, which today is 7,000 to 8,000 feet above sea level. Though at the top of the sequence, this limestone must have been deposited or laid down under the ocean waters, loaded with lime sediment that swept from northern Arizona and beyond. Other rock layers in the Grand Canyon also contain large number of marine fossils. The best example is the Red Wall limestone, which commonly contains fossil brachiopods. They're like small little clams, coral, bryozoans, which is another type of coral, crinoids, or sea lilies, bivalves, a type of clam, marine snails, and others, including even fish teeth. These marine fossils are found haphazardly preserved in this limestone. Marine fossils are also found high in the Himalayas, the world's tallest mountain range, reaching up to 29,000 feet. For example, a fossil called ammonite which is a marine cephalopod, you can look that up on your own time, are found in limestone beds in the Himalayas of Nepal. All geologists agree that ocean waters must have buried these marine fossils in the limestone beds. So how did these marine limestone beds get high in the Himalayas? We must remember that the rock layers in Himalayas and other mountain ranges around the globe were deposited during the flood. Well before these mountains were formed. In fact, many of these mountain ranges were pushed up by the earth movements in their present high elevations at the end of the flood, as recorded in Psalm 104:8, where the flood waters are described as eroding and retreating down the valleys as the mountains rose at the end of the flood. So we expect to see marine fossils everywhere on the earth, even in the mountains, if the mountains were covered with water as they were 23 to 25 feet above the tallest peak. Another example that we would expect to see is we would expect to see massive graveyards of many different types of fossils buried together, and that's exactly what we see. Andrew Snelling goes on to say this: countless billions of plants and animal fossils are found in extensive graveyards where they had to be buried rapidly on a massive scale. Often the fine details of the creatures are exquisitely preserved, like fossil jellyfish. Usually fossils are just the hard natures of what's left over of an organism, like bone. So in order for soft tissue, like the body of a jellyfish, to be preserved, it had to have happened extremely rapidly. Andrew Snelling goes on to say, for example, billions of straight-shelled chambered nautiloids, these are marine creatures, are found fossilized with other marine creatures in a 7-foot layer within the Grand Canyon. This graveyard stretches for 180 miles across northern Arizona and into southern Nevada, covering an area of at least 10,000 square miles. These squid-like fossils are all different sizes, from small, young nautiloids to their bigger, older relatives. To form such a massive graveyard, get this, it required 24 cubic miles of lime, sand, and silt flowing in a thick, soup-like slurry at more than 16 feet per second to catastrophically overwhelm and bury this huge living population of nautiloids. Hundreds of thousands of marine creatures were buried with amphibians. Now get this, it's not just marine creatures. These were buried with amphibians, spiders, scorpions, millipedes, insects, and reptiles in a fossil graveyard at Mont-Saint-Lémine in France. More than 100,000 fossil specimens representing 400 species have been recovered in the shale layer associated with the coal beds at the Maison Creek area near Chicago. This spectacular fossil graveyard includes ferns, insects, scorpions, and tetrapods buried with jellyfish, crustaceans, and other types of fish, and they still had all their soft parts preserved. Only a catastrophe with very rapid burial could bury these land and marine creatures together. You find graveyards like this also in Australia, where possums and whales were buried together. Now, how does that happen? Except if they were all in the same catastrophe, for example, like a global flood or a massive mudslide as a result of a global flood. You find this in Wyoming. You find it in Colorado. You find it in Chicago. You find it in Arizona, you find it all over the world, as we would expect to do with a global event. Let's take a look at rock layers a little closer. Now, this is something that's happened in our lifetime, if you're, we're born before 1980 at least. If we look at rock layers, does it really take millions of years to form, as evolutionary geologists and evolutionists would have us to believe, underneath uniformitarian conditions? That means it's the same uniform conditions happening over millions of years is how we see the rock layers of today. I don't believe that. I believe the Bible speaks against that very clearly. Or can rock layers form very rapidly under certain conditions? Let's look at Mount St. Helens eruption of 1980. The lateral blast of the mountain's north slope flew out at 300 miles an hour with temperatures as high as 660 degrees Fahrenheit and the power of 24 megatons of thermal or heat energy. Geologists watched this as their slow process of landscape forming was challenged as they saw the earth's surface and landscape change very rapidly right before their eyes. Icebergs were buried in hot avalanche material, forming badlands in days, not millions of years. Subsequent eruptions a few weeks later produced finely deposited layers of rock in hours, not millions of years. A month later, mud flows cut zigzag canyons, the most famous called Engineer's Canyon, 100 feet deep in soft sand and mud, complete with perpendicular side canyons, very reminiscent of the geography of the Grand Canyon, only 1/40th the size. So let me help you understand this. Engineer's Canyon came out as a result of the eruption of Mount St. Helens. It was formed in only 9 hours, and it looks very similar to the Grand Canyon, including the presence of a perpendicular side canyon within it. So it looks like the Grand Canyon, but it's 1/40th the size, and it did not take millions of years. It only took 9 hours to form the canyon. Over the next 10 years, mud flows cut through solid rock layers in just days of cutting time. Also, peat was formed at the bottom of Spirit Lake near Mount St. Helens in years, not millions of years. Like they say, it takes coal to form, and peat is the beginning of that process. It only took a few years, not thousands, not hundreds even, just a few years to form peat, the first layer or the first step in the process of forming coal. And we also see, in the grand scheme of things, this catastrophe was very small in scope to those of the past, especially that of something like Noah's flood, which was a global event. This example provides a better clue of what happened in the time of the flood when the fountains of the deep opened up and the slow geologic processes that we see today were challenged with the catastrophic events of a major catastrophe like the flood. 2 Peter says that scoffers are willingly ignorant that the world was once overflowed with water and perished. In Engineer's Canyon, what I was talking about, and you can look this up, that it formed in 9 hours, there's a little river running right through the middle of it. If we didn't see how the canyon was formed before our very eyes, in so little time due to the catastrophic event, evolutionists would say that that little river in Engineer's Canyon carved it out slowly over millions of years, like they say with the Grand Canyon and the Colorado River. Yet we can see how this landform, Engineer's Canyon, was created in mere hours in present time. It is observable science. Why would we not apply this observable science of a canyon being formed by a catastrophe in 9 hours and then a river appears in the middle of it? Why would we not apply that same process to the Grand Canyon? It's just on a larger scale with a little tiny river flowing through the middle of it. You see, when we do things according to the Bible, it makes sense. You have to willingly scoff at the evidence that is around you, as 2 Peter says, not to believe God's word to be true when it comes to the events of Noah's Ark and the global flood.